What up, meatheads? This is Travis, American Butcher, and this is the Meat Block Podcast, the weekly podcast by butchers for everyone. Oh man, was that three times? Was that a hat trick? I don't know, but I didn't mess up that intro that time. This episode may not have that much of me. I haven't decided yet because I'm recording the intro and I'm listening to everyone's audio and I'm about to go on vacation. I'm pressed for time and, you know, vacation, I haven't had much in, I don't think I've ever taken a vacation with my wife that wasn't like a staycation. Earlier this week, I did leave town, but I went, you know, as if you listen to the last week's bonus episode, I went to try out for the WBC and I'm for the American Butchers team, which would be huge. It'd blow my mind. And I may give a synopsis of what happened in that magical 8 hours of that day, trying out with such talent, Daniel, Cindy, Brian, and Kevin. And I was there as well. Danny, Tia, and Paul. And it was great talking shop with people in the industry who have passion or the same amount of passion as I do. And then Brian came out to my house and visited for a few days. And as this video's or episode is being released, he is currently working with Ryan, which is just like, you know, just crazy that what has happened with the meat block, it's almost like became like a symbiotic mold where it's taken on its own caricature and its own, like it's become self-aware and supporting itself where these connections are being made. It's just weird and crazy when I went down there and met these people that I follow on Instagram and that I look up to. And, you know, people like Daniel where I've seen his YouTube videos years, you know, before. And then he tells me that he listens to the Meat Block and it's just like, what? Or like, it's just weird. It's, I don't know. It's just humbling, awesome, and weird. But when I was packing up to go down to Taylor's Market in beautiful Sacramento, California, and I was like, okay, what is the likelihood I'm going to need this knife? What is the likelihood I'm going to need this knife? Should I bring seasoning? Should I bring jet netting? Should I bring string? Should I bring, you know, a mousetrap steel, my regular steel? And then at one point I was looking at my check-in bag and I had three different scabbers and I brought a gambrel. And at one point I had my slaughter scabber in there because what's the like, you know, because maybe I was going to kill something. Very unlikely, but there was that possibility. And just got me thinking about mise en place, everything in its place, which is very important in this industry that we need everything in its place. And that's what this episode is about. So I hope you enjoy Brian and David's take on mise en place as I'm on vacation.
Good cutting enhances the quality of good meat. Poor cutting results in an inferior piece of meat, regardless of quality.
Hey, meatheads. David here. When I was working my very first line cooking job that didn't involve making Mickey Mouse pancakes, I was working three jobs at the time, and I was only able to show up about 40 minutes before my long dinner shift on grill and sauté. On my first shift alone, after having the person that I was shadowing actually kind of retire from this spot, they weren't even there to ask questions to. I was a bit late because I was coming from my second job. To my surprise and horror, my station was basically unprepared. I mean, like all the food was there, all of the actual prep, and the product was stocked. But it had no garnish, no sauce, no stock, no fat, no vinegars, all of the things that you needed to actually execute the dishes. And I asked the daytime prep manager, who was still there trying to finish up the last few tasks before he took off for the night, and I asked him where all the stuff was, and he said, you know, you got to get here early enough to do your mise en place, or else you're going to be up shit creek. You're on your own. Mise en place. I didn't know what this was, and I asked him that, and he basically, you know, used some choice language to tell me I was not ready for this particular job, and he didn't answer me, and the rest of the night was awful. So needless to say, I got there a lot earlier from now on and stayed on time. So mise en place, what is this? It literally means everything in its place, or pudding in its place. In the cooking world, it refers to the gathering, placement, and preparation of a cook's tools, ingredients, and everything you need on hand and within arm's reach, for that matter, for a smooth service. Sometimes the difference between good and great is simply how an individual can set themselves up for efficiency and convenience. You know, for instance, when I was working saute at this one Italian restaurant, I needed to mount butter sauces constantly. And my cold butter was a pivot and two steps behind me, and my water was equally as far away. The stock was somewhere else. It was on the line. My acid was in another spot, as were my tongs and plating spoons. So one dish felt very disorganized. Felt like I was working way too hard. So we ended up repurposing kind of a trough or a shelf with sides, screwed it into the wall, and then it held everything. It was big enough for a little bit of an ice bath so that I could keep, you know, my butter and things cold. And it was all right there in the wall, and so I was able to stand facing the range and do all of my work right on the range and then just turn around to plate. And it was great, and it saved me a ton of time, and I became what seemed to be a much better cook overnight, when in fact I was just the same cook, but more efficient, moving around a lot less. In an NPR article entitled "For a More Ordered Life, Organized Like a Chef," Melissa Gray, a former student of the Culinary Institute of America, says, "It's a way of life. It's a way of concentrating your mind to only focus on the aspects you need to be working on in that moment and to rid yourself of distractions." Now, what's this got to do with margins and butchery and meat production just in general? Well, I think oftentimes plants are judged on their productivity, at least from a manager's standpoint. But when the margins are as tight as they are in this particular industry, you can't always add an additional employee to get the benefit of extra productivity. In this case, at least in my case, I don't have a ton of wiggle room in the labor budget, so my way of increasing productivity is through increasing efficiency first. And being well organized and efficient is one way of doing that. Let's use an early example of a mobile slaughter experience that I have. So this is actually the first full day on the job when I was working on a truck with Travis, as a matter of fact, out in Washington. When I got to the farm, which is where we were going to meet before heading up to the mountains, it was like a two-hour-plus drive up into the Cascades to this goat farm. Goats and hogs, actually. When I arrived there, the truck was already packed. The checklist was already checked off. I didn't have to gather anything. I just had to get in the truck. And so, you know, I knew that Travis hadn't gotten there at like 3 o'clock in the morning. What he had done is he had packed it the night before. I thought that was great because we didn't have to show up extra early. It wasn't stressful when I got there. We were very prepared. So we drive a couple hours out in the mountains. And then when we arrive, the place is already pretty much set up. They've got a place for us to go to the bathroom. The truck was brought out. Okay, that's what it was. now I remember, the truck was actually out there the night before. They had dropped it off just in case something had gone wrong. They got it all level. So not only was the truck packed the night before, but it was also dropped off, which added labor to people who were on salary. So there wasn't really an extra cost there because the owners drove the kill truck out, set it up, leveled it, got the drain field set so that we could just start going in the morning. There were two separate holding pens. It was one pen. Both were made of just woven wire fence. They're obviously temporary T-post fences, but they were really sturdy. And there was one pen that was probably 10 by 15 or 8 by 14 or something like that, where the goats were. And that was going to be the knocking pen. And then the same deal with the hogs. And there was actually a nice little setup with pallets. And close to there was a pump house that had electricity. I could see the hog stunner was set up. It was plugged in. And they had already tested it and were, you know, fairly certain that the breaker was going to accommodate the hog stunner's needs. There was a tractor nearby that had shackles already set up. It was either on the bucket or the pallet forks, but they were already there. And all we had to do was basically show up, put our scabbards on, go out, and just start killing goats. And that was it. You know, everything was completely set, dialed in, so that we were able to get the maximum amount of work done in the shortest amount of time. And it was very, very efficient from the get-go. There wasn't any sort of breaking in period. It was well thought out and was a great example to have set on my first day. We got a lot of work done, and we got out of there as soon as we could, and we really saved on a lot of labor because of the previous organization. Now, let me tell you about after Travis was gone, and I was going on my first kill off-farm, and I had forgotten a few details. I told the farmer to set up a pen with the hogs, get them all caught up. I told him all of the things that I needed, but I didn't physically go there to make sure that he had set all of these things up, right? So when I got there in the morning, it was, well, I meant to catch the hogs, but this thing happened. I meant to build a pen, but this thing happened. Oh, I have to have running water. I forgot about that. Yeah, I think I have extension cords for the stunner. We could just, like, plug it into my house or whatever in the living room. So off the bat, this thing was disorganized. And it was doomed. You know, it took an hour to set up a pen. It took another hour to catch the hogs up. The pen was too big, so every time I wanted to go knock another one, we basically had to catch it. The pen was so big that they could really get a running start or kind of juke us out of our shorts. And so we ended up, like, having to forego using the electric stunner because, A, we couldn't get them into an area where they were secure enough to properly stun the animal. But also, the extension cords that we were using, they were sitting in water. We ended up, upon testing it, blowing a breaker, and it just wasn't a good deal, so I ended up having to use a 22 mag for all these hogs, which, as you know, takes longer for them to kick out, to drag them into the truck. Causes blood spotting in the hams and the loins sometimes, and it's just all around more work, you know. So this preparation didn't go into it beforehand. I didn't bring the truck down the night before, and so we couldn't get it level, and I had, you know, processing water, like gray water and whatever else, backing up in the truck because it was rushing to the opposite corner than where the drain was. I mean, it caused me so much extra work that I wasn't able to get back to the shop before the end of the day, and I lost half a day of processing. This is a loss. It's a loss in productivity, and as we all know, time equals money. Since then, I've learned a lot of lessons about being prepared, and that's not something that really happens to me anymore. Not to mention, I do my pre-op inspections on the kill floor and on my cut floor. So while I'm doing that, I take the time to prepare us for the day. Now in the cut room, I have you know, it's been a lot of trial and error to figure out a system that works for our particular team, but we figured out a certain set of things that we prepare ahead of time, and we always stay one step ahead of, which really saves us a lot of time in the end. And when it saves us time, people don't really have to communicate too much, you know, superfluously. They're able just to work and do their job. We get a lot more done with a lot less frustration. It all starts with the office. Cut sheets need to be filled out and organized and as soon as humanly possible. When cut instructions are not filled out and that animal is on the rail ready to be broken, that's a huge monkey wrench because I need to sit down and call somebody, or we need to rearrange the rails, or it's just time, you know? So these are things that we've looked into, and we have our cut sheets at least a day prior, if not 2 or 3 days in advance, before that animal is scheduled to be processed. We make sure that the cut sheets are all filled out, because when I'm going down a hog and I've, you know, parted out the shoulders and I'm working my way down the line and I get down to the country ribs and there's no thickness selected, or someone forgets to circle bone in or bone out for the pork chops, I have to stop and go ask and go find out. And if I have to stop in the middle of a carcass and put it away because I couldn't get a hold of a customer, that's a major time suck. That's awful. So we just make sure that everything's filled out on time, and that really saves us a lot of time. We can get through more animals in a day without having to stop for this. We keep our rails organized. At the end of every day, I've got one person who goes in and organizes the rails based on the cutting schedule for the rest of the week. Sometimes things change, but we're able to adapt, and it really saves us a ton of time in between animals so that we can just move right down the list during the cutting day. When I'm doing pre-op, I place the scales where they're going to be needed throughout the day for different tasks, whether we're making patties or portioning something or pumping hams or cutting pork and seasoning, grind, things like that. Everybody's got a station. I make sure the scales are located in a way that we can utilize them the best, because there's nothing that I hate more than when I have to portion cut an entire beef, having to walk 30 or more steps to get to a scale. So I like to set that up during the day. All these footsteps cost you money. Each team member has a prep list. This is something that I do at the end of the day. It takes me very little time, and I find that it takes me less time to make a work order or a prep list for the day for the team members than it does for each one of them to get sidetracked or confused or make time management, you know, mistakes, or if people have to use the same equipment and things aren't coordinated, you know. By having a work order for the day, it really saves us a lot of time. We get a lot more done. When we have sausage production and we know what the size batches are going to be, our value added specialist Ross, who we've heard recently in an episode, he will mise out or measure out all of his ingredients into kits. So each flavor will have a kit. He'll measure everything out the day before. That way, when this meat comes available off of the table, he's able to just go and grab a kit for each one and season it right away instead of having to measure spices all day. We want this meat out of the cooler for as short a time as possible. Our processing room is very cold, but it's not as cold as the cooler. It's not the temperature that we want to be manipulating the pork with. So, and we don't have the ability to have our grinders in the cooler. So by having these kits all mised out, Ross is, or whomever is able to season these things very quickly and efficiently and get them back into the cold. Lastly, cleaning, cleanup. This is a big deal. We recently lost our cleaner at the shop, and he was really great and did a great job, and it's been difficult to replace him. So what we've gotten really good at over the last couple months has been cleaning our shop ourselves. And by being able to do this, we're able to save on labor costs by not having an extra person. Everybody gets to know the machinery a lot better. They become quicker and more efficient over time with cleaning, so that when we do find someone to take our ex-cleaner's place, this person's going to get a lot more done than the last person did. Because now that we are efficient in breakdown and pre-washing, we'll now be able to get our new cleaner to take care of the coolers and take care of other things that would normally cost me more time when I wouldn't be paying attention to product and clerical managerial items, which, you know, when paperwork's screwed up or when shipping and receiving doesn't go totally correctly or when customers just don't get a box, all of those things cost money and time. So I guess for me, the biggest contributor to get, you know, improving my margins, it's not leaving more of a tail of Bavette on the T-bones. It's not doing a 80-20 grind versus, you know, an 85-15 or something. It's really about controlling efficiency of labor, being able to do more work, being able to produce more, doing less work in the same amount of time.
MEP, everything in its place, mise en place. It's very important. It dictates the flow when you have all your knives. I certainly did not need three different scabbards of knives when I went down to Sacramento. I narrowed it down between four knives. Realistically, I use only two knives. I have this F-Dick blue-handled heading knife that's designed especially for silver skin that I brought, that I probably used, I don't know, at most a week's worth of my career. For some reason, I brought it. Being overprepared is just as bad as being underprepared. It was a knife I was uncomfortable with. It was a knife I shouldn't have used. The muscle memory wasn't built in. Should have stuck with the Gleicher 6-incher. But c'est la vie. But you know, when you're preparing MEPs or when you're preparing everything in its place for something that you don't know what is going to happen, you do stuff like that. But when you have done something before and you can expect what's going to come, such as making sausage or cutting, you get a sense that you need your knives, a trim barrel, a fat barrel, a bone barrel, and a waste barrel. Your trim barrel may be in a certain location. Your waste barrel may be on a camber on the ground underneath your bench. Your fat barrel may be adjacent to your trim barrel, and your bone barrel may be next to the saw. When you're cutting and you're flowing and getting in your idiosyncrasies, where your hands just move instinctively knowing that this goes here and that goes there. And something I have a specialty in is lean manufacturing. It's similar to MEPs, where everything in its place, where imagine every flow in every cutting situation and look at it from an outsider's perspective that it is wrong. At what point could you shorten the distance between your barrels? At what point could you take knife strokes down, get better yields, and time yourself? And you zoom out and look at the big picture. If you have three steps from your packing table to your cryovac machine, and you could shorten it 1.5 steps, how many steps is that overall? Instead of your vacuum sealer going into luggers and then getting packaged, what if they went straight into boxes? And during your downtime, you made those boxes and pre-labeled your bags to the best of your ability. Simple things like having your casing soaked the night before, encouraging your employees to sharpen knives, not during cutting hours. Or the most important in my line of work, having your cutting instructions or your cut sheets done prior to knife in hand. Every day at my work, we have morning team meetings where within 7 minutes, we go over how we want the day to go and address any concerns with how that would happen with labor. We will address species separation in order of cutting. Sausage is the stuff from mild to hot and spice blends that need to be made before the sausages get mixed. Although this is not visual and tangible items as MEP of having your knives and having your whatever, this is a verbal or dialogue of MEPs that we know what needs to happen to achieve our goals for that day. And saying it out loud will help prevent any hiccups that may come up. This next piece is by Ryan.
Butchery work can be eerily like midwifery at times. When the baby is on its way, it's on its way. Once the process has been set in motion, often there's no turning back. Once the animal has been knocked with a captive bolt or a firearm, there are a series of timely events that need to take place if the goal is to guide this carcass through the chemical and compositional changes of death in the most favorable way, producing the most palatable outcome. The butcher's hand is guiding this process, and certain errors made can become amplified on the plate, significantly detracting from the final eating experience. True professionals are very meticulous about timing and precision, performing their tasks of slaughter work from an instinctual level, a felt level. They understand how certain factors need to be addressed so that a small problem or small error doesn't snowball into something larger and more grievous. When a slaughterman bleeds the animal after knocking, they're trying to do so fairly quickly, while there is still low-level brain activity and while the heart is still beating. Performing a precise jugular stick in the proper time frame and after brain death will prevent unnecessarily pooling of blood within the muscle structures and ultimately minimize the amount of blood-stained tissues the meat cutter will then need to trim off later on down the line at the cutting table. A slaughterman will instinctually then focus on reducing and minimizing the overall bacterial load present on the carcass as they are skinning and dressing out. To the untrained eye, an observer will not understand why the slaughterman spends extra time doing things like curry combing the tail, curry combing the shanks and underbelly, or extra time trimming certain areas of the hanging carcass. The slaughterman develops a sixth sense for the nearly invisible world of bacterial load, microbial load. The degree to which a slaughterman understands how to reduce harmful bacteria, to my mind, is the variable that separate the men from the boys in this line of work. Many of the best slaughtermen are refrigerator Nazis because they understand that there is a big difference between a walk-in cooler that ages beef well and a cooler that produces moldy, slimy, and tacky beef. Factors such as proper cooling in the hot box, proper circulation of air, control of moisture levels, and overall microbial levels makes the lion's share of the difference not only in final cutting yield, but also in texture and taste on the plate. It is misguided to judge a slaughterman's competence solely based upon speed and durability in the battlefield. While mastery of knocking, bleeding, skinning, and gutting is clearly very important, it is the way that a slaughterman stages each sequence of events that is most revealing of their depth of knowledge. Each job that the slaughterman performs sets the stage for the next job and the next after that, like a chess player that can clearly see 10 moves into the future. My boss once quizzed me, asking, Ryan, what's the most important step when dressing a carcass for food safety and to set up the best possible aging of the carcass? Is it the washing, the trimming, or the acid spray? So he gave me a multiple choice, which is nice of him. But the answer, the correct answer, is trimming. If you trim off the specks of feces, hair, and dirt, then you are removing them entirely from the carcass. And consequently, you will not be bringing them back into your cooler. Now, who cares about feces, hair, and dirt? Those are representative of a certain type of bacterial load. All of these things coming from the exterior of the hide. And that's where the type of bacteria, the type of microbes live that we are trying to keep off of the hanging carcass, the dressed out carcass. So if you trim them off, then you will not be bringing them back into your cooler at all. Washing and spraying perhaps may dilute the amount of harmful bacteria at best, but the bacteria will still be present and perhaps may contaminate other carcasses and proliferate in your coolers, resulting in poor aging and many other possible headaches. Just like on an acid trip, or just like leading up to a good lovemaking session, set and setting cannot be understated for the slaughterman. It is the lead domino. Andrew Turner, Slaughterman, Custom Slaughterman, Andrew Turner, in episode 43 of the Meat Block podcast, offers hard-won advice for set and setting process improvements he's learned in the custom mobile niche. Details such as the position of the kill truck, proximity to the animals, these things are critical for success. Are the animals corralled? Who's doing the handling? And is it smooth, easy handling or stressful, frenzied handling? Is there adequate drainage at the knocking site? The midwife, the professional midwife, knows set and setting very well. She knows how to create a scene that is most conducive to the type of outcome she would like to see. Gentle lighting, familiar faces, familiar scenery, verbal reassurance and verbal cues to help the mother focus on working effectively. She knows where the moments of greatest risk are and knows how to recover a situation that is veering slightly off course. She knows about what are the duties that are within her ability to perform that will have the biggest favorable impact. We had midwives present at all three of my wives' births, and these midwives would expertly step in at very key moments to help my wife through sticking points as she labored and eventually birthed each of our babies. They knew when my wife needed to try a different position to move things along. They had many tools in their toolbox and to help things go smoothly. Though their technical skill mastery was outstanding, it was the seemingly small details they did behind the scenes that added up to create the correct environment for a successful birth to take place. And it is this same degree of flow management that can allow a slaughterman to go years and decades without cutting themselves or without having any major catastrophes at the knockbox. Details such as how is the winch pulling the animal? Does the winch rope need to be modified, pulled slightly 1 inch to the left or the right? Is the animal settling into the cradle correctly? Where are the sinks and hoses, water sources positioned in proximity to the site where we're doing the dressing out? Who's doing what task, and the coordination of movements with your fellow coworkers. When done well, the occurrence of mistakes is greatly minimized, and The events clip along like a well-oiled machine. The scenery is set in such a predictable and intentional way that you could do the tasks blindfolded. Everything is in its place. Travis recently reminded me of the culinary expression, mise en place. Mise en place. I had an experience recently that reminded me of how critical this mise en place, this everything in its place concept is. There I was. It was after 8 p.m., and I was getting my kids ready for their bath. When my neighbor walks up with a funny look on his face, he's wearing coveralls, latex gloves, is a little sweaty looking. Hey, Ryan, can I borrow you for 15 minutes? Hey, Ryan, can I borrow you for 15 minutes? 15 minutes of your time, is what he says. I'm thinking to myself. He explains that he has just shot a hog that he bought from a friend and is currently skinning it, but ran into a problem area that he can't quite figure out on his own. I was more surprised by the whole thing rather than annoyed. My neighbor had told me months ago he was thinking of buying a just over market weight hog and trying to process it at home. At the time, I had told him I would help him when that time came, but I hadn't heard a word about it since then. And now here he is, up to his elbows in it, asking for help. And I got my kids hanging off me, ready for a bath and ready for bed. And my wife is at work, so I have no one to hand them off to. And it's a Tuesday night. I say, sure, I'll be right down. Why? Because this guy has gotten himself into a pickle. And my heart goes out to him. So I pack up my kids. We walk down there. Here's the scene. He's built an aluminum rail that extends from the exterior of the building that he lives in into and across the ceiling of his garage. Just outside the garage door, he has the hog gambrelled by the hind legs, and the gambrel's attached to a mechanical winch hoist he has fastened to the outside of the building. Currently, he has the hind legs, or the rumps, as you'd say, skinned. And then he got confused as he was attempting to skin the flanks of the hog where the belly is. It's a tricky area there because if you do not keep your knife perfectly flush with the interior of the skin along this flank area, you'll be cutting into and mutilating the pork belly section. And the belly is often turned into bacon. So the bacon section. It is really nice to have a smooth, uniform rectangle of belly for smoking. Not a pockmarked, gouged out, surface of the moon type trapezoid shape. And even with a generously fat animal such as the one now hanging in front of me, my neighbor had already come away from flushness with the skin and was gouging deep crevasses into the belly with his extremely dull knife. Now, a word about hog skinning. Hog skinning has been described to me by seasoned slaughtermen as, quote, hands down, the most difficult technical skill that exists in butchery. It is like filleting the sinew out of a flat iron steak, but it's even more tricky than that. It's a concentration marathon. It is very, very difficult to do at all, let alone do well. So here's my neighbor, bless his heart, a very well-intentioned guy, good father, good husband, good worker. Here he is up Shit Creek without a paddle. Scratch that. He was up Shit Creek, and I was his paddle. So I skinned out one flank for him, kind of recovering what he had done, showing him how to skin it all the way down, back deep into the front shoulder, all the way close to the spine. got him, and then I got him started on the next flank, on the other flank, and got him off on the right path with it. And then I narrated to him exactly what he would need to do to finish the skinning job. I made him repeat it back to me so I knew he wasn't confused about it. And then I peaced out with my kids, who were rapidly deteriorating, as they tend to do in the final hours of the day before bed. After skinning, gutting, and splitting, his plan was to winch it onto the rail he had created, roll it into the garage along that rail, and then chill it in a small chamber he had made at the end of his rail. He duct taped three or four panels of insulation together around an open beer fridge that he had the door open so that the refrigerator was lowering the temperature of the whole chamber that he'd created, hoping that the beer fridge would drop the temperature of that chamber and also drop the temperature of the hanging pig. 2 days later, around dinner time, I came over to help him cut the beast into steaks and roasts. Now, cutting a hog, even a large one, doesn't take more than a few minutes at my place of work. So I was kind of looking forward to helping him cut the thing. I knew my wife and his wife would be present to wrangle the kids and wrap and label the things we cut. So I was feeling good about having some bro time in the garage with my neighbor and his hunter friends as I gave them pointers about how to break the thing down. Based on his description of the cutting day event, I was picturing 6 or 7 hunter types crowded around the cutting table in the garage, overly excited to have a knife in their hands and chomping at the bit to get after some meat cutting. I imagined I would be there to orchestrate the event, answer questions they may have, and maybe demo a technique or two. Nope. It was just me and my neighbor. He was like, "Okay, what should I do?" And I was thinking, "Oh shit, I thought there'd be more people here." I realized I better just get started getting after it because we had a lot of work to do. So I broke off the shoulders for him to fiddle with, and I got busy with my knife on the rest of it so we wouldn't be there all night. In case you're wondering, the carcass had not cooled well, but it was just passable, where I didn't think we would get anyone sick. The trachea was still lodged in the neck, but otherwise he had done a good job gutting. After all, he had dressed out a few deer carcasses over the years, so he wasn't a complete beginner. But all things considered, I'm pretty sure he was aware that he'd gotten himself in over his head with this backyard hog project. Dressing out and cutting a fat hog is a far cry from dressing and cutting a lean deer or elk. It's a whole different ballgame that requires different techniques and strategies. And even though the whole project was, by most measures, super inconvenient and annoyingly foisted upon me, possibly taking advantage of my good-natured, bleeding-heart disposition, it was still kind of fun. I was the perfect guy for the job, not because I'm a professional butcher, but because I used to do these exact same type of overly ambitious, ridiculous butchering projects in my garage back in the day. Earlier in my career, I had such a hunger to do this work that I was always bringing home sides of beef and pork to cut and wrap at home. I was always in over my head with those projects. I'd be sweating the whole time I was doing them, super stressed out, flipping through tutorial books and YouTube videos, just trying to not fuck things up too bad. It's kind of a comedy of errors when doing these type of projects. And so I looked upon my neighbor's efforts and my neighbor's short-sightedness with a certain type of nostalgia and fondness. It reminded me of my roots. As the two of us, mostly me, were cutting, his relatives and friends did begin to arrive, but they were not there to help us cut. They were there to watch, to chat, to ask questions, and generally to distract me while I was working. Little kids kept coming up and saying, "Ew, gross. That's so gross." The parents would quickly say, "It's not gross, honey. This is where our food comes from." The truth was that I was thinking the exact same thing as those kids. Now, all day at work, I'm literally swimming in animal carcasses, both on the butcher truck and in the cut and wrap facility. Fat and blood and feces and slime soak my hair, splatter my face, and soak through my clothing. It doesn't bother me in the least. But here I was working with this lukewarm, almost bone-sour hog that hadn't chilled exactly right. And I was thinking the whole time, ew, gross. This is fucking gross. The exact same thing as those kids is what I was thinking. The table I was cutting on was too small, too short. The rail was an awkward height. I was cutting the whole thing with a knife only, no saw. The floor was gravel, and when a ham accidentally slid off the table once, I picked it up, and it had probably 100 pieces of half-inch minus gravel embedded in it. Yes, it was still butchery, but it was just as different from what I do at work as painting the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel is from playing Pictionary. At work, my job is all about making things easier and easier for ourselves, more and more streamlined. All the little details become very important. And then we try to refine those details further and further until the work hums along with a smooth, effortless cadence. Travis reminds me that this is exactly the wisdom of mise en place. Everything organized and everything in its place with intentionality is what allows chefs and butchers to reach higher levels of performance and just plain makes our lives easier. There was nothing easy about getting blindsided by my neighbor in his last-minute hog processing project. But the midwife side of me was awakened, and there was no way I wasn't going to help this guy through the labor pains and the struggle of it all. An ordinary sense of time goes out the window, and a butcher's time clock sets in. Social norms flake away once the animal has been knocked. Boom! Once the animal drops, some other part of my brain seems to kick in. Some other set of senses comes to the forefront. Partly, it's a feeling of duty. This is my role in the community. And there's an excitement, even amidst strange and unfamiliar circumstances, an excitement based on my knowing that a favorable outcome is imperative. There's a lot of ways things could go sideways on us. A ton of ways. Any different point, things could go sideways on us. And I'm here to guide this event, steer it safely away from the traps, the dangers, and towards the bounty of a full freezer, towards the bounty of a delicious meal and dinner tables and people sitting down and coming together. I think midwives must have a similar sort of freight train of meaning bear down upon them when they get that phone call that a soon-to-be mother's contractions have begun. From that moment, they become entwined with the spirit of the event. Not too different from the moment when my neighbor showed up at the witching hour, wearing his coveralls and latex gloves, flushed and harried looking, asking, "Can I borrow you for 15 minutes of your time? Do you have 15 minutes? Just come down, show me." I got all confused. I'm mixed up. I don't know where the belly is. Can you just point out the belly to me? God damn, I'm a butcher man.
So, MAPs. It's Travis again. It's like packing for a vacation. which I'm on right now as you're listening to this first vacation in a while. I'm sure I said it earlier in the episode, that you want to make sure, what do you need when you're on vacation? Or translate that, what do you need when you make this sausage? What do you need when you cut this meat? Do you need a knife? Do you need a way to hone that knife? Do you need a place to store that knife? What if that knife cuts you? Do you need something to prevent that on your hand? Once you cut that meat, where is it going to go? And from that place, how is it going to get out? What's the quickest steps to go? MEPs and lean manufacturing go hand in hand. View every process like you're doing it wrong. And also ask outsiders to look at your flow to see if they could shorten it and shorten steps. To relate it back to this sweet vacation in my hometown of Santa Barbara, California, probably enjoying In-N-Out for the fourth time. It's like packing. How many days am I going to be there? Am I going to have access to a laundry machine? How many socks am I going to need? How many underwear am I going to need? Am I going to need a phone charger? Is make sure we have my son's iPad. Make sure we have a car seat. Make sure the rental company, blah, 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 blah. What do we need to make this a success? And that's how every day of work should be viewed. What do you need to make that day successful, profitable? You don't want to overpack, bring three scabbards worth of knives, bring a tri-stone when you haven't used one in 3 years. Bring 20 pairs of socks, a ski suit in case it snows in the middle of summer in Santa Barbara, a climate that doesn't snow, regardless if it's winter. Because the more time you spend preparing and better preparing means the more time you can spend relaxing. I hope you're enjoying your summer because we're halfway through it, meatheads. And hopefully I am enjoying some margaritas on the beaches of my hometown of Santa Barbara. Till next time, keep your knives sharp and live.
Nibbling on sponge cake, watching the sun bake, all of those tourists covered in oil. Strumming my six string on my front porch swing. Smell those shrimp, hey, they're beginning to boil. Wasted away again in Margaritaville, searching for my lost shaker of salt. Some people claim that there's a woman to blame, but I know it's nobody's fault. I don't know the reason, stayed here all season. Nothing to show but this brand new tattoo. But it's a real beauty, a Mexican cutie. How it got here, I haven't a clue. Wasted away again in Margaritaville, searching for my lost shaker of salt. Some people claim that there's a woman to blame. Now I think it must be Buffett's fault.
blew out my flip-flop, stepped on a pop-top, broke my leg twice, I had to limp on back home. But there's booze in the blender, and soon it will render that frozen concoction that helps me hang on, hang on.
Wasted away again in Margaritaville, searching for my lost shaker song.
Some people claim that there's a woman to blame, but I know this is all Alan's fault.
Yes, and
some people claim that there's a woman to blame, but I know it's our own damn fault.
So I'm in Santa Barbara for my vacation, which is actually my hometown. I don't really know if going home to your hometown is a vacation or not. I imagine. I always said when I'd go on vacation with my wife that it would be, you know, to places with beaches, but when you grew up with beaches and et cetera. But anyway, we're going down there and it's fiesta right now. Fiesta, the Spanish word for party or celebration. And what are we celebrating? So in 1912... the great earthquake hit Santa Barbara, destroying the Wild West town. The mission town, the rich town, the town with the view, the oil town. The movie There Will Be Blood, Daniel Day-Lewis's house at the end of the movie is based on a town of Santa Barbara where he kills that one guy in the bowling alley. But we're going down there for fiesta. What is fiesta? So when this earthquake happened, they wanted to rebuild the town, and that's when they decided to rebuild it in Spanish style. Even though it was a mission back in, you know, the 1700s and 1800s. And it's the mission is still there. It's one of the only two missions with two, or one of the only missions with two bell towers. If you ever read the book, Island of the Blue Dolphin, that Indian or Native person is buried in that mission cemetery. Maybe this has more significance to me because I am a native Californian. In fourth grade and sixth grade, you're supposed to do Gold Rush and mission projects. The mission I picked was San Juan Capistrano, even though I'm from the city of Santa Barbara. So the mission dictated the Spanish architecture that they would rebuild the town after the 1912 earthquake. They decided on Spanish architecture. And in 1920, they were complete. Also completed the Santa Barbara Bowl, which was designed for horse shows. At the end of the completion, they had a celebration, a parade, running from State Street to the Santa Barbara Bowl on Milpas Street, which now is not a bustling street. I'm assuming they went through Annapurna, which is a beautiful street nonetheless, but is not a street that people talk about when they think of rich history of Santa Barbara. But to celebrate, they had a party, a fiesta. Then it became a tradition, the first week of August, to have this fiesta. And so on for many years to come. Fiesta, also known as Old Spanish Days. You go, it's appropriate to get drunk in the daytime, have an egg smashed on your head full of confetti, and eat copious amounts of tacos. Because now I do post-credit scenes. That's what I decided to talk about.